Welcome to Author's Voice, a virtual book signing network. I'm Daniel Weinberg, and we're here at our studio embedded in the Abraham Lincoln Bookshop in Chicago, where since 1938, we've dealt in historical books, photographs, autographs, ephemera, lithographs of all sort, and all pertaining to Lincoln, the Civil War, U.S. presidents, and general American history. Please visit our bookshop at alincolnbookshop.com. Author's Voice streams live on all your favorite digital devices. We feature author interviews in every book genre: children, fiction, science fiction, even romance, historical fiction, mystery. And we've hosted such people as Cokie Roberts, John Meacham, Wesley Clark, Doris Kearns Goodwin, and many others over our last 11 years. Today you're watching A House Divided, dedicated to Lincoln, the Civil War, and U.S. presidents and general American history, as I've said. We are live on Author's Voice, so while we are, please send in your questions and give us your name and where you're from so we can acknowledge you as well. If you are new to us, leave us your email so that you're not going to miss future authors, so that you, your family, kids, and friends will not miss authors that they would like to see and interact with. We offer signed first editions of our authors' books, so please use our website for an order form and build yourself a fine home library for you and your family. Today, we welcome C-SPAN once again to our shop. And if you're watching it on C-SPAN, I'm sorry to say you can't leave a live question, but you can go to our archive and go to previous shows, and you can watch the 11 years of what we have done. And perhaps there will be some signed first editions still available. Today, we are very proud to welcome Peter Cozzens. This is not the first time Peter has been with us. He walked into our shop as a 15-year-old interested in Civil War. And now look at you, Peter.
That was just 3 years ago.
Right? This is 3 years ago. And you're a retired Foreign Service officer, retired now. In 2002, you were awarded the William R. Rifkin Award, which is the American Foreign Service Association's highest honor for exemplary moral courage, integrity, and creative dissent. He's the author or editor of 16 books on the American Civil War and the Indian Wars of the American West. Among them are separate works on the battles of Stone River, Chickamauga, Chattanooga, a biography of John Pope, A Life for the Nation. And he's added to the original Battles and Leaders, four volumes from 1887 to 88, with his Battles and Leaders of the Civil War, volume 6 and 7. He's also written the Eyewitnesses to the Indian Wars of 1865 to 1890, published in 5 volumes, and also Shenandoah 1862, Stonewall Jackson's Valley Campaign. Peter's latest book is The Earth is Weeping, the epic story of the Indian Wars and the American West. Alfred Knopf is the publisher. It's 544 pages, well illustrated with numerous detailed maps, and it's $35. This is a true historical page turner, Peter, written with verve and movement, I found. And you still keep the large number of actors and places and actions understandable across a vast geographical area and a vast time as well. By the way, we were talking just before, and here we have first editions of your book, and I've always told people that first editions are not scarce, second editions are scarce, and yours is going into second edition.
Second printing before publication.
Even before publication. So how did the book come about? Is it a natural extension from the Eyewitnesses to the Indian Wars? And how did you derive the title as well?
Well, my interest in the Indian Wars in general derived from my work on the biography of John Pope, because I was surprised. John Pope was generally dismissed by history after he was sent west to fight Indians following his defeat by Robert E. Lee. I discovered that he had played quite an important role in the Indian Wars. More importantly, that he had extraordinarily humanitarian views of the Indians and the plight of the Indians. It was very sympathetic to them. At first, I thought it was unique to Pope, and I discovered that that was a prevailing point of view on the part of most of the Army High Command. And I found that remarkable, that the degree of empathy they had for the Indians and for their circumstances and their plight. And so that led me into the Indian Wars. The title is not a quote, it's from my own imagination, but it derives from, you'll find various combinations of lyrics in Indian songs of the period that we use, of course, Earth, Mother Earth, sad, weeping, all to reflect their deteriorating situation in the West.
Well, your sources, you begin your study, of course, as the eyewitness to the Indian Wars, and you expanded the battles and leaders as well. But with the Indian Wars, this book really gives a balanced view, maybe one of the first to give such a balanced view between the whites and Indians. What sources were most valuable to you in researching this book?
Of particular value, I'll speak principally of the Indian side, because the white sources are more apparent: army diaries, memoirs, reports, letters, newspaper accounts. On the Indian side, there were a number of ethnographers, both professional and otherwise, who took testimony from Indian warriors at the end of the Indian Wars, while they still were young enough to recall what occurred. And those provided a rich resource, and also congressional documents. It seemed like anytime anyone sneezed in the West during the post-Civil War Indian Wars, Congress called a hearing. And quite often they invited Indian chiefs to actually come out and testify before Congress to present their point of view. And that provided another rich source. And there have been, again, memoirs of a number of Indians that were taken down while they were still alive that have been published in recent years. So I was able to find enough credible, vivid sources of Indian participants at all levels to tell a story, I believe, right down the middle, 50-50, from both Indian and white sources.
You know, you have wonderful maps in this book that really help the reader, certainly helped me as I went through the book. Will you give me an overview of the Indian population and the tribes in the West? What do they look like? Where did they come from, in fact? What was the peopling of the Western Indian Plains, especially?
Well, I'll speak of the period from 1865-66, when the narrative proper begins in the book, although, of course, I provide background. You can't really say with any great degree of certainty what the population was, but it's estimated that the total Indian population of the West was approximately 250,000, of whom perhaps 75,000 resided on the plains, and the rest in other parts, in the Southwest, Northwest, and California. The principal tribes that I deal with in the book are going from north to south on the plains, the Lakota Nation, also known as the Sioux, the seven tribes of the Lakota, the Northern Cheyenne, the Arapaho, going farther south, the Kiowa, the Comanche, the Apache in the southwest, in the northwest, the Nez Perce of Idaho, the Modoc of Northern California, and then among the tribes that were friendly to the government, the Shoshone of the Rocky Mountains, the Crow of the Northern Plains, and the Pawnee of the Central Plains figure most prominently. And the tribes of the plains, there was a lot of, let's say 150 to 200 years before the action begins in the book, there was a lot of jockeying among the tribes on the plains. The Lakota, the Cheyenne, the Arapaho, all these tribes were originally woodland tribes from east of the Mississippi River that were gradually pushed west by expanding white settlement of the United States. And they then clashed with tribes that were native to the plains and pushed them away and occupied the lands that have come to be associated with them.
Where do they go, the indigenous?
The Crow were pushed closer to the mountains. The Black Hills, for instance, which have always been a source of contention, originally peopled by the Kiowa, they ended up going south and becoming united with the Comanche on the southern plains. Other tribes like the Mandan and the Hidatsa and the Arikara were pushed further north or were decimated almost to extinction by smallpox and other white man's diseases.
You mentioned in the book that you write that was one set of immigrants displacing another set.
That's one of my principal theses, and that dawned on me in the course of my research when I realized that, in fact, the Lakota, the Cheyenne, the tribes that we associate with the most closely with the Great Plains and the Indian Wars were relative newcomers themselves. Again, they had been on the plains for 150 years at most. So it was, again, one wave of immigrants displacing another, in a manner of speaking.
I'd like to get right up front to the thesis of your book. What is your assessment of those wars in the West, the basic theme running through? First of all, there are basic misconceptions that all of us have had about both the Army and the Indians, and especially the government policy of extermination, allegedly, and the Indians themselves, who you're mentioning quite a bit, did not stand up united against the white settlements coming at them.
Exactly, and I would argue, and I do put this forward early on in the book, that I believe there's no period in American history that is more deeply steeped in myth than the era of the Indian Wars for the American West. In fact, it's this mythology that has developed since Wounded Knee that has really guided the public's perception of the Indian Wars for the first 80-odd years after the Indian Wars. The perception was that of the Army as sort of the shining white knights of the government and of white settlers, and Indians as bad cardboard cutouts, as foils to the Army and the government. And then in 1970, the pendulum sort of shifted to the opposite direction with books like Bury My Heart and Wounded Knee, which told the story from the perspective of the victim, so to speak, and films like Little Big Man. And so it's always been the pendulum swings that have informed our understanding. And what I've tried to do is tell the story again in a balanced fashion.
Let me ask you this: there was our man Abraham Lincoln presided over the beginnings, perhaps, of the wars in the West up in Minnesota with the Sioux uprising. I once had a demitasse spoon from the late 1880s, perhaps 90s, that had in the spoon itself the hanging of those 26 all Indians all together out of the 300 plus that were going to be hanged. Lincoln did pardon all the others except for those 26 who were hanged. Was this really the spark for the wars that followed?
Before I answer that, could I add one point to our last question? I just want to mention what I consider to be the three most egregious myths pertaining to the Indian Wars. One, that the Army was hell-bent on killing Indians. That is not the case. I think I dispelled that in the book. Two, that the government policy, as you suggest, may have been exterminationist. It wasn't in any sense of the word. And thirdly, that the Indians were united. They were divided not only among themselves within tribes, but also continued to fight tribal warfare between tribes throughout the period. What was your question on the Minnesota uprising? Was that the spark? No, not
really.
It was
really in the middle of the Civil War.
Yeah, what it did was make Westerners a lot less tolerant of Indians in their midst and a lot more suspicious and a lot more willing to treat the slightest provocation as perhaps perhaps portending a general uprising. In fact, it was in that poisoned atmosphere in the months after the Minnesota uprising that, of course, Sand Creek occurred, and that reaction was so dramatic in part because of the fear that was bred by the Minnesota uprising.
Let's get into some of the internal conflicts that there were over and over again. There were internal conflicts that I saw on both sides, actually, which surprised me a bit how divisive they were within each group. Both the Army and the Indians had those divisions between, especially with the Indians, between those that were ready to have peaceful settlements and those who wanted to resist aggressively. Explain these divisions, please.
There was no tribe that fought the government, that fought the Army, that was ever wholly united for war or peace. Not a single tribe. Every tribe had its peace and war faction. And it really boiled down to a question of whether a particular faction, whether the Indians believed that resisting the whites was, in fact, a policy that stood any chance of success, whether it was futile or they were better off trying to accommodate and acculturate. So quite often would be the case. The government had a policy of bringing chiefs to Washington, D.C. to sort of overawe them with the power of the whites. And chiefs would come back from Washington, D.C. after traveling across the country and realize that their small tribes with 3,000 or 4,000 people stood no chance in the long run. And these chiefs would often become the heads of the peace factions and seek accommodation as really the only possible way of surviving. The only time that there was unanimity was among the tribes that united with the government, like the Shoshone and the Pawnee and the Crow.
It's interesting that I collect the Black Hawk War of 1832, because Lincoln was in that war, if you can call it that, only about 3 months and that was it. But they brought it, at the end of it, they brought Black Hawk to the East, same way, to overawe him. And he went back and stayed peaceful after that. It was interesting that they brought him up the eastern coast to be seen in Baltimore and Philadelphia, right, from Washington. And Andy Jackson was going up at the same time on a tour, a political tour, and Black Hawk was bringing more people to him than to Jackson. Did people come out in droves to see the Indians, the chiefs?
At first. In fact, my book begins with a conference between President Abraham Lincoln and a delegation of Cheyenne chiefs. And after their tour of Washington, D.C., which included the Union fortifications and so forth, P.T. Barnum arranged a deal with their Indian agent to take them to New York City, and they were paraded around New York City, and P.T. Barnum had, I forget how many shows, but it went on for at least a couple of weeks, and to sold-out audiences, and they were great novelties. But after a while, these delegations became so frequent, almost like revolving door delegations, that the novelty, I think, wore off on the part of the Americans in the East.
My technical staff has asked me to read this. If you're having buffering issues with today's show, please close and reopen your browser. Return to authorsvoice.net and select the low speed stream. So please do that. We want to keep you with us over here. There were also intra-tribal conflicts that kept them from having unity. There were some, of course, that tried that. The Sioux and the Cheyenne had some, were together a number of times. But what was this the major or one of the major aspects of the defeat of the Indians, that they could not unify against the common threat?
Beyond a doubt, it expedited their defeat. The problem arose from the nature of Indian society in the West. It was a warrior culture. a young man could not even court a girl, could not even look for a wife until he had accumulated war honors. And war honors were obtained at the expense of white settlers or soldiers were not considered to be nearly as worthwhile as those taken from combat with other Indians. And so the intertribal wars, again, there was just bred into the culture. And this intertribal conflicts continued throughout the course of the Indian Wars. So you know, while the Sioux or Lakota were facing threats from white miners or settlers on the one hand, they were also at the same time trying to push the Crow further west out of their country. And the tribes were never quite able to focus their attention entirely to the white threat.
Was this the same in the Northwest, far Northwest?
Not so much. Things were pretty settled there. Tribes like the Nez Perce had been in their homeland for quite some time, and there was some of that, but far less pronounced than on the Great Plains.
Hmm. Let's talk about warriors versus soldiers, which you do quite a bit. You say that the Indians were brave, hardened, but loosely organized, but seemed to be better warriors. The soldiers were better equipped and organized, with more resources to draw from, certainly from the East, but they were ill-trained and less qualified than those during the Civil War and poorly officered. What happened, first of all, from the Army? Why did the Army devolve from the Civil War and those who were in the West were not up to the same sort of standards that we all have read about in the Civil War? And the same with the Indians. What sort of warriors were they, and how did they organize their campaigns?
The Army, of course, volunteer Army that fought the Civil War mustered out very quickly, and Congress was intent on paying down war debt as rapidly as possible. And they just kept snipping away at the Army from approximately 50-some thousand to fewer than 30,000 by the time of the Little Bighorn. Just kept snipping away. And as they did so, they also decreased incentives to join the Army. In fact, the pay of a private soldier during the Indian Wars was less than that of a volunteer private soldier during the Civil War. And so with the exception of the period of the financial panic of 1873, there were really no incentives to enlist in the Army. And most who did enlist ended up deserting as quickly as possible. Their desertion rate in some regiments was as high as 85%. Men came west at the expense of the government and deserted at the first opportunity to go work in the gold mines or to start up on their own. And in fact, the Army was more concerned about losing equipment than about losing manpower. And so you had a very low quality of enlisted men, and the officer corps, when promotion opportunities were so slow, because promotion through the rank of lieutenant colonel were within a regiment, and a lieutenant coming out west at the start of the Indian Wars after the Civil War, I forget the exact amount of time, but could expect to wait upwards of 25 years before making major. In fact, someone in the Army and Navy Journal commented that, you know, in a few years, we're going to have an officer corps that's going to be too old and crippled to fight. You know, they're going to be just a bunch of hobbled old men. So incentives were low, both for officers and enlisted men. Training was non-existent. There were no centralized training facilities like we have today. You were mustered in, you went to a training so-called training depot, but then you're immediately sent to your regiment. And there was not only no time, but also no budget even for target practice. The warriors, on the other hand, these boys were raised from childhood to become warriors, and so that was their culture, that was their way of life. One Army colonel called them the best natural cavalry in the entire world.
You know, because we're an antiquarian shop, we have true artifacts, and here is one: a journal of Army life that Rodney Gleason, wrote, although this is prior to your book, Army life must have been awful. And you're talking about the desertion rates. So did it remain that throughout the war?
Throughout the Indian Wars. And conditions were actually better in the frontier before the Civil War, because during the course of the Civil War, the Army posts that were in the West were allowed to fall into disrepair. And William T. Sherman, General Sherman, went on tour of the West at the start of the Indian Wars and wrote a scathing report on the condition of the posts. And he made one comment, just to paraphrase it, he said that the press were to see if black overseers and black plantation owners had kept their slaves in conditions as filthy and miserable as that of which our soldiers live, there would have been a greater hue and cry before the Civil War that these posts, in fact, one regiment, when it came out west in 1866, had to shovel inches of bat guano out of their barracks before they could even settle in. I mean, buildings were, in many cases, troops had to sleep on the parade grounds because the barracks were so rickety they might fall over in a windstorm. It was just atrocious, and the lack of budget and lack of upkeep.
Yeah. Dances with Wolves was just on, and Kevin Costner reminded me of this. Did any of these people who deserted or others go Native? Certainly George Crook, to some extent, did.
I know of no case of an Army officer ever deserting and going Native, but
the soldiers themselves?
There are a handful of cases, one in particular during one of the conflicts on the Southern Plains. The Indians were believed to have fought directed by bugle calls, and the bugler was believed to have been a deserter from a black unit, one of the Buffalo Soldier Regiments. So there were a handful of deserters that went over to the Indian side, but no officers like in Dance with Wolves, no.
We had Ron White in here just a week ago with his wonderful book on Grant, American Ulysses. And we have a question from Maurice Jeffries from Louisville, Kentucky. By the way, you can go on site and authorsvoice.net and watch the interview that we had. It's really wonderful, and this is a spectacular book that leads right into this and this question. Thank you, Maurice Jeffries from Louisville, Kentucky. What were the underlying reasons for Grant convening a secret meeting at the White House to provoke war with the Lakotas? Was it the panic of 1873 and the need for cash that gold in the Black Hills would bring, or pressure from Sherman and Sheridan and others who were pro-expansion? Up to that point, Grant's attitude was considered sympathetic to the Indians. In fact, we learned in Ron's book that he was the first president to bring up Indian rights in his inauguration.
Right. The answer is the former. And perhaps this gentleman read an article that I just wrote in this month's Smithsonian Magazine, in which I devote the entire article to the question of this secret cabal that Grant organized to provoke war with the Sioux, provoke the Great Sioux War that led to the Little Bighorn. Grant's reasoning rationale was he wanted the Black Hills for the mineral wealth. And the reservation chief, Black Hills, were on the Lakota reservation, been promised to the Lakota for perpetuity. And the Lakota chiefs, reservation chiefs, wouldn't sell. So Grant's thinking was, and Grant, as what scant evidence there is very damning. And it's impossible to escape the conclusion that this was Grant's decision, this was Grant's thinking. And it was a question of choosing between even though he wasn't running again, between the electorate, so to speak, and then the needs of the nation during a continued economic depression, and the rights of the Indians, and he chose for the former. The thinking was, if we provoke a war with the Lakota, who are residing off the reservation but still on land promised them, speaking principally of the bands that followed Sitting Bull and Crazy Horse, if we can defeat them, that defeat would put pressure on reservation chiefs to sell the Black Hills to the government, and we could obtain them and mine them for all they were worth.
Well, the peace policy that Grant proclaimed after
right.
this worked for many years. Before that, yes, and for many years it continued. But it changed, and he changed. And he decided not to have the same peace policy, but to really become more aggressive, just like Sherman and Sheridan wanted to be. What changed him?
Fundamentally, he didn't. The peace policy continued as the official policy with, I think, the best of intentions by President Grant, really up until the whole question of the Black Hills arose. That was really what did it. I mean, it wasn't a case of it gradually falling into decline as so much it ending abruptly with this secret cabal in the White House to plan out a means of provoking a war with the Lakota.
To actually provoke that war.
Actually provoke that war, yeah.
You know, how did the press get into this? And I have here a War and Pestilence. This is really from the Black Hawk War again. But at the same time, this was a time that this pamphlet really did provoke the populace against the Indian. And what was the role of the press at those days? They were following the army as they went along.
The press was ubiquitous. In fact, that's, again, another one of the excellent sources that I used in the course of writing my book. I probably cite upwards of maybe 50 newspapers. Correspondents traveled with the army, or if a conflict developed, they would flock to the scene of the conflict, and the accounts of the correspondents, and they would often interview the Indian participants as well. In fact, one of the best accounts I have of what was called Hancock's War, one of the first conflicts, was a series of dispatches to the Missouri Republican by a fellow named Henry Morton Stanley, of Dr. Livingston,
Africa, yeah.
Right, fame. He was a young stringer with the Missouri Republican and a New York paper. And so the press was ubiquitous. In general terms, the Eastern press was sympathetic to the Indians and to the Indian rights. The Western press was, in many cases, exterminationist.
Well, they were right there.
They were right there. So there was an extraordinary dichotomy.
Well, you talk about the humanitarians that were in the East. Did they have that influence?
They had a huge influence. In fact, they were the Quakers in particular were influential in the Grant's developing a peace policy. He turned over a large number of Indian agencies and superintendencies to management by the Quakers and other religious organizations. And the ironic thing about all this is the Eastern humanitarians, in their desire to save the Indians, they saw nothing worthwhile in Indian culture worth saving. So they were agents of cultural genocide, just as much as the government was. I mean, they subscribed to the prevailing belief that Indians had to be, and again, in the parlance of the day, Christianized, civilized, concentrated on reservations for the Indians to have a chance of surviving, which was, and again, in light of the times, it was not necessarily an immoral or unrealistic way of looking at things. But again, the humanitarians had a very paternalistic view of the Indians. You know, they wanted to save them, but not their culture.
So they had this, but they weren't influential enough to do much more, I guess.
They weren't influential enough to stop the conflicts that arose, and oftentimes they were sympathetic when the conflicts arose, sympathetic with the army. Depended on the particular conflict. It's hard to really generalize. But the influence of the humanitarians really came front and center after most of the fighting was over, in terms of, okay, now the fighting's winding down, we've got most of the Indians on reservations, how do we speed their acculturation? And that's where when the humanitarians really stepped in full force.
Well, there was another internal conflict, and that's between the War Department and the Bureau of Indian Affairs. And that went on throughout this book, bickering over Indian policy and the eye ring being part of this. Did they influence public opinion as well? And what was that conflict and bickering between them?
Absolutely. It was again, over control of the Indian affairs. The army saw the Indian Bureau as hopelessly corrupt and not without reason. In fact, the Indian chief, this was a standing joke of the day, an Indian chief said to General Sherman, he said, you know, our Indian agent is a great man. When he comes, he brings all his belongings in a little hand valise. And when he leaves, it takes two steamboats to carry them away. So there was so much corruption, so much diverting of goods and monies that were intended for the Indians. And the army was well aware of this, and they railed against it. The Indian Bureau, their counterarguments, which lacked a certain amount of moral basis, but they argued that, well, that the army was a decivilizing, if that's the word, influence on the Indians, and the army would, the wrong people to have, and the War Department was interested in constant conflict, so they were not the appropriate home for the Bureau of Indian Affairs. That was the argument of the Interior Department, when in fact the opposite was the case. I mean, as General John Pope once said, he said, you know, we have no interest in provoking Indian wars. We, you know, Indian war means hardship, means being separation from our families and all we love and cherish. The army did not want these wars. So that was an ongoing issue throughout the Indian Wars as well.
We have a question from Norville in Louisville. Norville, thank you very much. You are always giving us questions. We appreciate it. Based on your massive Indian War study, how does General Crook compare to General Nelson Miles? I use the Encyclopedia of the Indian Wars all the time.
I can't answer that in black and white. Read the book, Nelson Miles That's right. and Crook and their rivalry, because there was an intense rivalry. More on the part of Miles, who was probably the most ambitious general of the 19th century, than on the part of Crook. But there was an intense rivalry between the two for promotion throughout this period. In a nutshell, I would say that Miles, for all his ambition, all his vaunting ambition and his backstabbing of fellow officers, was uniformly humane and just in his treatment of defeated Indians, whereas Crook talked a good game. He enjoys reputation even today of being uniformly humane in his treatment of defeated Indians. He wasn't. He did a lot of double dealing. But at the end of the day, he too was sympathetic in the larger sense with the Indians. In terms of who was a better commander, it's a difficult question to answer, because fighting the Indians also involved diplomacy and politics and managing them after they were defeated. But I guess if I were pressed, I would give a slight edge to Nelson Miles in terms of consistency. George Crook performed, I guess I could say, miserably during the Great Sioux War, as becomes clear in the book.
There are so many conflicts and actions and tribes and officers and men that populate this book that all we can do is put spotlights on a few of them and hope that you at home will want to read this fine book. And I think that's really the way to understand all of this. And I also want to say that, again, my technical staff has asked me to say that we are having some streaming issues, and we're experiencing that today. The low band is having technical problems. Those of you who are going to be on the archive will see this entire show. So do come to the archive at authorsvoice.net, and you'll be able to see all of this as well. The higher speed is working now, they say. So if you're experiencing buffering issues, you can watch the program in its entirety on its loaded YouTube and go to Author's Voice. Something I want to ask about are the Indian Scouts. I don't know if this is still in the craw of Indians today, that there were Indians that did help the army. Pawnees, for instance, were some of those that did that. The Crows were another. Could the army have succeeded in what they did without them?
Would have taken a lot longer.
More death on their part?
They would have needed far greater numbers. It would have taken a lot longer even to find hostile Indians. The role of Indian scouts and auxiliaries was decisive in almost every conflict in the book, most particularly in tracking down hostile Apaches. The Army used Apaches to fight Apaches, and without the Apache auxiliaries, Geronimo might still, and his descendants might still be in the Sierra Madres of northern Mexico. The Pawnee, for instance, if you watch the TV series Hell on Wheels, you never come away with this realization. That is that had it not been for a unit called the Pawnee Battalion, which was recruited specifically as and equipped as regular soldiers, two companies of Pawnee, to try to prevent these nonstop raids by the Cheyenne and Lakota on the construction crews and the survey crews of the Union Pacific, had the Pawnee Battalion not existed and given such a drubbing to the Cheyenne and Lakota war parties, I personally estimate that it would have taken at least a year, perhaps longer, for the Transcontinental Railroad to have been completed. The Pawnee Battalion was instrumental in the completion of the Union Pacific Railroad. This would not have happened nearly as quickly without them, to give one example of how important.
I was struck as a student of the Black Hawk Wars of 1832, as I've mentioned, how much the policies were the same. Everything was the same west as well as east. And with the Black Hawk, the Sac and Fox Indians, they were lead miners, fairly settled to some extent as well. And those lead mines is what brought the whites to them and to kick them out. And here we were, the same thing with mineral rights in the Dakotas and elsewhere in the West, that the whites wanted that land for mineral rights. Some of it, of course, was because of the panic that occurred, and certainly that was part of the problem, that everyone was looking for gold, for instance, to help the economy out east.
That predated the Panic of 1873, and it also postdated the California Gold Rush. Gold was the great dispossessor of Indian lands. It was gold that led to the settlement of Denver, Colorado. It was gold discoveries that dispossessed the Nez Perce of some of their lands. It was gold in Northern California and Southern Oregon that led to conflicts there. It was gold in Arizona and New Mexico that led to conflict with the Apaches. Gold, gold, gold everywhere. Every time there was a major gold strike, dispossession of Indian lands would follow apace. Absolutely. That never, gold or silver or...
Are we reaping the same thing today with pipelines? Out west, we're having that problem today.
Exactly.
Bob from Albany has asked, Mr. Cozzens, please talk about the use of alcohol on both the Indian and Army sides.
I'm not sure how many times I indexed the word alcohol, but it's one of the longer index entries in the book. The use of alcohol was ubiquitous on both sides. The officer corps was rampant with alcoholics, and I devote a couple of pages just to the use of alcohol in general among the soldiers and the officers. The most famous case, of course, was Major Reno with the Little Bighorn, who was drunk throughout the battle, and was so drunk he couldn't even organize a defense at Little Bighorn. And Indians, entire villages would fall prey to alcohol and be on constant, constant long-term binges. It was a real destabilizing, unfortunate influence among the Indians, and it was ever present in the Army as well. George Armstrong Custer was one of the few teetotalers in the Army, I think.
I want to ask you about the strategy that the Army had. Here we have Randolph Keim's Sheridan's Troopers on the Borders, a winter campaign on the plains. Was the winter the time that the Army tried to displace the Indians because they were in their wiki-ups for the winter, frankly?
On the plains in particular, right.
It wasn't the same with, you brought up the Apaches. It wasn't the same out there.
No, because Apaches lived in temporary shelters that were easily dismantled, and as opposed to the plains Indian tribes who, after the autumn buffalo hunt, they would settle in to usually well-sheltered river bottoms that provided a good source of water, good wind breaks. They would set up their lodges, teepees, for the winter, and their ponies would grow gaunt. Their mobility would become virtually non-existent, and they were sitting ducks, so to speak. And so that evolved pretty quickly as the Army's choice time of year to launch Indian campaigns. Of course, the Army faced great challenges themselves. Some of these winter campaigns took place in 30 and 40 degree below zero temperatures.
I was cold just reading this book.
These poor guys were out with frozen canteens and frozen hardtack and frozen meat, and falling off your horse if you weren't revived at once by someone meant almost certain death. But the Indians were stationary, and the Indians never expected to be attacked in the dead of winter. They believed winter to be their best ally. And even though battles like the Washita, where Custer attacked Black Kettle on the Washita in the dead of winter occurred, the Indians never quite were able to come to terms with this vulnerability, and they really didn't have any way around it. They had to hunker down for the winter.
Mentioning the Washita, Custer was there, and you absolve him from that massacre. It was a very lopsided battle. And you absolve him from that, although there were other aspects. Elliot, for instance, was left on the ground, and people like Benteen, who everyone knows from the Bighorn battles, was slow to help Custer. I'm wondering if, first of all, talk about why you absolve him from that massacre, and did Benteen hold a grudge at Little Bighorn and go too slowly to try to help Custer?
The Washita was in no way, shape, or form a massacre, and anybody who calls it that is being grossly unfair. It was a battle. It was horribly lopsided. Custer was following the strategy laid out for him by General Sheridan, following the tactic that the Army had decided on, which was attacking the villages during the winter. He outnumbered the Black Kettle's village enormously. He had nearly 800 men. Black Kettle had perhaps 60 warriors. Black Kettle was the peace chief, but there were warriors in his village who had participated in raids on Kansas settlements, rapes and murders in Kansas. And Custer issued strict orders, and unlike what you see in Little Big Man, Custer really meant it. He issued orders against killing of women and children. But those deaths were inevitable. When you were riding into a village that contained women and children, it was inevitable that some would die. And there were cases of women, too, picking up weapons and fighting the cavalry. But there were some atrocities at the Washita. They actually were committed by Custer's Indian scouts. And when Custer heard that one of his companies were firing on women, he sent a courier to put a stop to it at once. So Custer never intended to make war on non-combatants, but to a degree, those kind of collateral losses were inevitable. So you can question the humanity of the overall strategy, but to say Custer was out to kill civilians was wrong, and it was not a massacre. A massacre, of course, by definition, is a one-sided, intentional killing of people who were unable to defend themselves, and that was not the case. In fact, Custer lost more men at the Washita than the Indians lost warriors.
So was there a connection with Benteen at this point?
Benteen, yeah. Major Joel Elliott rode off with a small detachment on his own hook to chase some Indians and became quite separated from Custer in the main body. And by the time Custer was aware of his departure, Custer himself was in danger of being surrounded by a superior force of Indians who had been camped downriver. and were beginning to appear in the battlefield. So Custer had to make tracks. He could not hang around and look for Major Elliott. And Benteen blamed Custer ever after for, in his mind, abandoning Elliott. Plus, Benteen had a chip on his shoulder from the fact that he'd been demoted from colonel to captain, and he really believed himself to be a better officer than George Armstrong Custer, and perhaps better officer than almost anyone else. Benteen had quite an ego. I don't believe that caused him to move slowly at the Little Bighorn. He had been sent on by Custer on what he thought was a fool's mission, a scout to the left, so to speak, and he believed Custer did it to reap the glory for himself. But once Benteen became cognizant of the fact that there was fighting going on, he picked up the pace.
Well, let's talk about Custer and glory. I don't want to go into Custer too much. You tell the full story in here, and many people know of that story anyway. But in the Civil War, you write that Custer instinctively knew when to charge, hold fast, or retire. And you quote, "His head was always clear in danger," it was quoted at the time. So what happened? Did he have political ambitions, perhaps to become president? Is that what happened at Little Bighorn?
I think that whole theory is pure nonsense. Custer, at the time he broke free of General Terry at the Yellowstone River on June 22nd, 1876, and began his three-day ride in search of the Indians, the best intelligence that the Army had was that the 7th Cavalry alone would outnumber the Indians. The Army was not aware of this huge accretion of Indians that were coming from the reservations to join Sitting Bull's village, and which caused the Indian warrior strength to grow from 600 or 700 to over 1,500, perhaps as many as 2,000, and within the course of a week or so. Custer was not aware of that. Even his scouts believed that there were only a few hundred warriors. He had discretionary orders. In fact, he was encouraged by Terry once he found the Indians to give battle to them, because everyone realized how difficult it was once you found the Indians to engage them. And invariably, if the past were any indication, that the Indians would break camp and flee. So Custer was operating under the best intelligence that the Army had at the time. And again, it's like we could spend an hour on this, but his action, I fault him only for separating his forces. That's the only place I really find fault with him. And of course, that proved to be a fatal mistake in view of the size of the Indian village.
Talk briefly about the Indian agents. Certainly a vicious and scurrilous lot, it seems. Is that across the board, for one? Is that how we should view the Indian agents? They really did take advantage of their posts?
Indian agents, those who owed their appointment to a political patronage, which were the majority during most of the Indian Wars, there were some who were upright and had the Indians' best interests in mind, but they were not in the majority. And there were some very scurrilous, very crooked Indian agents. There was a period during Grant's administration when he turned over some of the crucial agencies on the plains to the Quakers and other denominations. They ran the agencies honestly, but oftentimes displayed incredible naivete when it came to dealing with the Indians. There were instances in which the Army was given control of the agencies from time to time. They invariably ran the agencies well and honestly. And in general, Indians preferred Army officers as agents over civilians, because the Army officers, and if an Army officer committed malfeasance, he would be court-martialed. He would suffer the consequences.
And they knew it.
And they knew it. And the Indians knew that, absolutely.
What about the commissioners, the Indian commissioners? L.E. Parker is in here, of course, on Grant's staff during the Civil War. We once had in our shop the table at Appomattox on which he wrote out the terms of surrender that were then signed by Lee and Grant. And he had a beautiful hand as well. And he was placed as an Indian commissioner. He was a Seneca Indian by Grant, but he eventually had to leave that post, and he left it kind of quickly. What was the role of the Indian Commissioner, kind of briefly, and did they have any influence in all of this?
The Commissioner of the Bureau of Indian Affairs oversaw all relations with tribes, with non-hostile tribes. And so they managed all the Indian agents, all the Indian superintendents. Most of the agents were honest, but there were also some corrupt, most of the commissioners were honest, but there also were a handful of corrupt Indian commissioners who became locked in scandal. Even the best intended, like Parker, himself an Indian, believed that the Indians' only future lay in acculturation.
We haven't gotten into a lot of the battles, and there's so many of them, and so
right.
Fascinating. And again, they're written with real movement in your narrative, so that we want to turn that page and hear about another one as well and what happened. I didn't get bogged down in any of this. One interesting one was the Battle of Beecher Island in 1868, which I didn't know much about at all. And Chief Roman Nose was there, Colonel George Forsyth on the other side. What brought me to it, frankly, was there was a Jew there as well, a man named Sigmund Schlesinger.
Schlesinger,
who was credited with scalping three Indians and also killing a coyote that fed the starving soldiers next to him. And actually, there was General Fry later on wrote this poem in 1893 to him. This is only one part of it. When the foe charged on the breastworks with madness and despair, and the bravest souls were tested, the little Jew was there. Well, a little patronizing, okay. But nonetheless, he was there and made his mark. But Beecher Island was a fascinating little battle. And what was its influence?
It's interesting that you said soldiers. They weren't soldiers.
Surveyors.
They were actually scouts, civilian scouts. A kind of a ranger force of civilian scouts that Sheridan got up because the Army had proved so inept at fighting the Indians during the summer, during the months when the Indians were mobile, which is, of course, led to the whole winter strategy. The Army was so inept that he wanted to strike some blow against the Indians, and so he decided, okay, who better to fight them than experienced plainsmen? So he recruited 60 plainsmen, and had one of his staff officers, George Forsyth, lead them to try to find Indians, and they found them. They found they were outnumbered about 10-1 and were besieged at Beecher Island and survived, barely.
Barely.
Yeah.
Are there any controversies in the wars out west that you feel are still controversial, that you have not been able to decide one way or the other what really happened? Is there any one or two that come to mind? And maybe none.
No, not really. And I'm not saying this to try to sell books necessarily or to sound at all arrogant, but even Wounded Knee, I won't spoil my conclusions, but they may surprise some people, but I came to a conclusion that I'm pretty comfortable with as to the question of whether or not Wounded Knee was in fact a massacre. Hmm. So in terms of the individual conflicts, I feel that I've resolved them to my satisfaction after 4 years of research and writing.
And that's the best part of this book, to get your take on this, someone who really has delved into this greatly. There's an Indian museum you talked about to me prior to the show that you really feel that everyone should go to.
The Buffalo Bill Center of the American West in Cody, Wyoming, I can't recommend highly enough. And if you're going out to Yellowstone, it's worth the extra hour and 15 minutes to go to Cody. It's a remarkable place. It's one museum dedicated to Buffalo Bill, one to weapons, the greatest weapon collection in the United States of antique weapons. And then a Western art museum, and one museum dedicated to the Plains tribes. And it's an absolutely superb museum. So if you really want a museum that will impart to you something of the feeling of the Indian Wars and of the West in general, that is the place to go. That is the place.
I'm going to put you to work while I talk to our audience for a few moments and sign some books for us and for you as well, of course. First of all, as I said, this is such a vast book. It's very difficult to be able to get into everything. And I was just looking at some of the things that I wanted to ask. The Nez Perce War, we were talking about Wounded Knee, which was very important, and the ghost dance religion that was there at the same time, and Red Cloud, and Sitting Bull, who we've not gotten to, and some of the strategies that are there. We certainly haven't talked about the armaments that you speak about in depth here, and also the Indian chiefs that were there, and what the chief was and what they meant. So I really encourage you to do this. Army forts, by the way, is another one that I noticed that we didn't get to, that were a fascinating thing, how they thought there was going to be a line of armaments from the forts themselves. It did not take place. So here is a book that you really should get to. It's an important book. It's up for the Pulitzer. Is that correct? So get to it before it gets it. You'll be the first one and have a first edition signed copy as well. I want to tell you about some of our upcoming shows on Author's Voice. A House Divided, our show here, Saturday, November 12th at noon. Timothy Smith will be here. Grant Invades Tennessee, the 1862 battles for Forts Henry and Donelson. A good friend of ours, David Powell, the Chickamauga Campaign, A Barren Victory, volume 3 of his trilogy. That's Saturday, November 12th at noon. Also, Saturday, December 3rd at noon, Central Time. These are all Central Times. Another old friend of ours, Noah Andre Trudeau, is coming in with a fascinating book. I've already begun it, Lincoln's Greatest Journey, 16 Days That Changed a Presidency. And also another fascinating work, a little different, Mark Zwanitzer, The Statesman and the Storyteller, John Hay, Mark Twain, and the Rise of American Imperialism. Fascinating book. John Hay, of course, came out of with Lincoln, one of his secretaries, and was the second part of co-authored a magisterial 10-volume on the history of Lincoln. So at authorsvoice.net, Saturday, December 3rd at noon Central Time, you want to come and see those two authors and those two books. Meanwhile, here is one that you've got to get to, and we're so happy that you were able to come here and that Knopf, your publisher, sent you here. Appreciate that, and hope you will come back again. You tell me that you're writing your next book, which is going to be the Eastern Wars on Tecumseh up through War of 1812, and so we hope you'll come back for that as well.
Absolutely.
I want to thank all of you out there in Webland and for coming and supporting us by purchasing books and coming and watching us. I hope you'll do that again. I want to thank the staff of the Abraham Lincoln Bookshop who help Author's Voice and make it possible to be here. We appreciate C-SPAN for being here as well and looking over our shoulder once again, and we invite all of you to continue to join us here at Author's Voice. Thank you again, and have a good day.